deploying Airflow on GCP using Autoscaling. But first, let us introduce ourselves. My name is Anita Fronczak. I'm a software engineer at Google. I've been working on Cloud Composer and Airflow for 1.5 years. I've been working as a software engineer for more than 10 years now, including work on data platform. Mateusz?
And my name is Mateusz Henc. I'm a senior software engineer and I've worked for Google for 4 years now. At first, for almost 3 years, I have been working for GKE UI team. And I joined Cloud Composer about a year ago, and Autoscaling was one of my main projects from the beginning there. And today we would like to share our findings. Back to you, Anita.
Sure, hi. So let us start. First, I'm going to introduce you to the topic of Autoscaling and Cloud Composer. I'm going to run you through current Cloud Composer architecture and its elements. Then I'm going to explain why we decided to introduce Autoscaling. In the end, I'm going to give you a high-level overview of the implemented solution. Mateusz is going to tell you about the actual implementation. First, he is going to tell you about the metrics used for Autoscaling. Then he's going to show you detailed architecture. And at the end, tell us about plans for the future. So why Autoscaling? Before we can answer this question, let us clear us some terminology so we are on the same page. As you probably know, in Airflow, computation is defined as a direct acyclic graph of tasks. Each DAG execution is called a DAG run, and it contains of task instances. In Airflow, you control parallelism by setting following static parameters. Scheduler parsing processes. It's the number of processes to process DAG files. Each processor has a separate set of DAG files to process. Salary worker concurrency, number of salary processes per Airflow worker. Each salary executor picks up a task from a queue to process. There's also core parallelism parameter that defines the max number of task instances that should run simultaneously. It should be actually the worker concurrency times number of workers. And at the end, we have DAG concurrency. And the number of task instances allowed to run concurrently by the scheduler. Airflow 2.0 introduced scheduler high availability, allowing you to have more than one instance of that scheduler. We're not going to talk about it, but I'm sure there is a presentation about it, as it was a big thing in Airflow 2.0. Airflow also offers pools mechanism. Airflow pools can be used to limit the execution parallelism on an arbitrary set of tasks. When you create a pool, you give it a name and assign a number of worker slots to it. Composer Autoscaling solution does not use pools, but it also does not prevent you from using them. It's an additional mechanism. So here is a topology of current Composer's architecture without Autoscaling. Cloud Composer is a Google Cloud offering of open source Apache Airflow. It manages deployment and runtime of Airflow on GCP, providing services like logging and monitoring. Airflow workloads in Cloud Composer run on Google Kubernetes Engine, GKE for short. GKE is a fully managed Kubernetes service. And Kubernetes is an open source container cluster manager. It manages your cluster resources like machines, networks, disks. Both Airflow scheduler and worker run as Kubernetes pods. A pod is a group of one or more containers with shared storage and network resources, and a specification for how to run the containers. All of it runs on Compute Engine. Compute Engine is a secure and customizable compute service that lets you create and run virtual machines on Google's infrastructure. In a current deployment, we have one Kubernetes pod for running Airflow scheduler and user-defined number of pods for running Airflow workers. This deployment runs on a user-defined number of cloud compute machines, which size is also defined by the user. Oof, that was a lot of terminology. So Let us start with the actual implementation. So the solution that I told you in a previous slide is a good working solution, but it has its drawbacks. First, the number of nodes does not change with the traffic. Also, once you have chosen your machine size, you can no longer change it. In a current setup, you have one worker per node, so the number of Airflow workers is constant. What you are paying for are the cloud compute machines that you reserve for that setup. The cost is constant, no matter the actual node usage. With the current setup, users have come back to us with the following problems. They often do not know how to size their environments to their needs upfront. It can lead to wasting compute resources and higher cost, but it can also lead to Airflow workloads failing in the case of resource exhaustion. Not all parameters in the current setup can be changed later on. Customers have a varying load during the day. They often scale the capacity to the peak, and during low hours, those resources are wasted. Also, it would be nice to process peak load faster. Those are not only problems for Composer users. If you deploy your Airflow using that topology on GCP or another cloud provider, you will run into similar problems. Let us start with another piece of terminology. Let us define what autoscaling is. So autoscaling generally provides capabilities that let you automatically add or delete compute resources based on increases or decreases in load. Autoscaling helps your apps gracefully handle increases in traffic and reduce cost when the need for resources is lower. GKE implements full Kubernetes API, including autoscaling. GKE offers horizontal pod autoscaling, controlling number of pods, and cluster autoscaling, controlling node pool. Node pool is just a pool of compute nodes, which you can understand as machines or virtual machines. We have implemented horizontal autoscaling of worker pods, meaning number of workers automatically adjusts to the load. We do not offer vertical autoscaling, meaning that worker resource requirements like CPU, memory, and disk do not change automatically. But we do offer possibility to change worker resources manually after the environment has been created. We have not implemented autoscaling for Airflow scheduler, but Airflow scheduler parameters like CPU, memory, and disk are separate from worker parameters and can also be changed after the environment has been created. To make that work, we use GKE cluster autopilot. With this solution, user no longer manages cloud compute nodes, but only Kubernetes pod requirements. GKE cluster autopilot changes cost model from compute node-based to pod-based. With this model, you pay for your chosen minimum number of workers when there is no load, and for at most chosen maximum number of workers where there is load. You no longer care about bin packing of pods to nodes. Here's a simplified architecture for autoscaling solution. We still have one scheduler pod. Number of worker pods is dynamic and varies depending on a task load. This is controlled by horizontal pod autoscaler. Cluster is managed by GKE autopilot. Mateusz will explain all the details later. This implementation supports well use cases like varying load during the day with a mix of small and medium tasks. It also supports use cases like a few bad jobs a day with no work to do in between. What it does not support well is big machine learning tasks requiring huge machines for a few hours. In this case, better use Kubernetes pod operator with a machine created especially to handle the task. If you have both small and huge tasks, you will have to size your pod to huge tasks. So during small tasks execution, your pods will be underutilized. This is how you configure Cloud Composer autoscaling. You can change machine settings for worker and scheduler separately. They can be changed after the environment has been created to better match your load. You can also set minimum number of workers to always have some capacity in case tasks come. To be able to cap the costs, you can use max number of workers setting. If you want to disable autoscaling, just set minimum workers equals maximum workers. Mateusz will now dive deeper into how we implemented this. Mateusz, the presentation is yours.
Okay, thank you, Anita. So let's take a deeper look. So as Anita mentioned, we use horizontal pod autoscaling. So this is a nice feature that Kubernetes offers for resizing the number of pods. Like under the hood, it's a process running in GKE master. So it means it's free of charge for the end user. And it automatically scales the number of pods. It is metric based. So we need to provide it with a metric based on which HPA decides to scale up or down. And by default, the most commonly used metric is average CPU usage. Like it makes sense for web applications or web servers, but it won't be very useful for Airflow. The reason is the limited number of tasks running in parallel by a single worker in Airflow. So CPU usage may not be high, but there are no free slots for more tasks. And from the other side, it is possible that we have a single CPU intensive task that takes all the CPU resources on the worker, but adding more workers won't help there. But fortunately, HPA supports external metrics that can be read, for example, from a cloud monitoring. So let's look at how we actually designed our metric. At first, we asked ourselves a question: how many workers do we need to run all the tasks that we have? And to find this, we need to take the number of the tasks in the queue and the worker concurrency setting. If we divide one by another and round it, we get our value. To calculate the metric, we also need to know how many workers we have right now. So having this, we can introduce a new metric and export it to cloud monitoring. Just know that HPA requires us to provide the metric in scale factor format. So 1.0 means no change, 0.5 means we need half of the current number of workers, and 3.0, there should be three times as many workers as we have currently. So we can change the number of worker pods. We need to be able to run additional pods somewhere. And while Kubernetes schedules a pod in the node, it runs the bin packing algorithm. So it takes into account the pod CPU and memory request and looks for a node which has at least this amount of resources free. In Composer, without autoscaling, we didn't have requests. So Kubernetes used the best effort resource allocation, meaning that if a pod wanted additional memory and it was free in the node, then it just got it. This approach will not work with autoscaling because the infrastructure need to scale up together with the number of workers. That's why we had to introduce worker and scheduler size definitions like CPU, memory, and storage, and they are actually provided as a user input. We also changed the type of a GKE cluster from standard to autopilot GKE, which automatically adjusts the number of nodes and actually the machine sizes to the current needs. Okay, so let's go through the flow of the autoscaler so we can see how it actually works. Assume we have an environment with a single scheduler and a single worker. And as I said, we rely on the autopilot GKE cluster to provide infrastructure to run them. So everything begins when the scheduler puts more tasks in the queue. And as Anita mentioned, we use Solar Executor. Of course, some of the tasks are processed by the existing worker right away. But if there are more of them than three slots, then they are queued. The size of the queue is read by the monitoring component. This is actually the Composer system pod responsible for exporting different type of metrics and check the healthiness of the environment. And for us, it does the calculation of the metric value using the algorithm that we described before. Then this that this value of this metric is exported to cloud monitoring, and we do it every 60 seconds. From there, it can be read by HPA, which is configured to use this external metric. And based on the value of the metric, HPA may decide to add or remove some worker pods. Worker provisioning takes, of course, some time, and it depends on a few factors, like do we have a free space on the node, or does GKE needs to create a new node first, or is the container image cached on the node, or does it need to pull it from the container registry? From our tests, we see that this may give additional 2 to 4 minutes for pod startup. So this is actually the full flow of the autoscaling. Of course, everything happens in the loop. So HPA constantly reads the value of the metric and adjusts the number of pods. And just a note, so HPA does not apply the changes right away. We use stabilization window. So this is actually a feature of HPA, of stabilization window of 70 seconds. And why 70 seconds? Because as I said, we export the metric every 60 seconds. And we want to rely on 2 consecutive metric values before we apply any change. We actually saw that the metric tends to fluctuate. For example, like in situations when some tasks were done, while the executor didn't manage to put new tasks in the queue yet. This also helps for many quick tasks that current set of workers are able to handle, even though the queue may look pretty long. The main problem that we tackled during the project was handling scaling down. So scaling up is easy. We just add a new worker, it's registered, and executes the task from the queue. There's a problem with scaling down. Some of the workers may still run tasks, and killing that worker means that the task is stopped and needs to be retried by another worker. And of course, this is unacceptable, because imagine we have a 2 hours long task, which is like super expensive, and restarting it means we'll have to abandon all the current state and start it from scratch. And by default, or the non-autoscaling solution, we use Kubernetes deployment, which for scaling down just picks a random worker to be removed. So we have to find some workaround for it. The problem was solved by replacing the deployment controller with a custom Kubernetes controller. So just a note, what are Kubernetes controllers? So these are processes that are responsible for reconciling the state of the world according to the configuration. So for example, if configuration says that we need to have 3 pods of some kind, but we have 4, then the controller is responsible for removing one of them. It works in Kubernetes using a watcher pattern and executes every time something changes, so either configuration of the state of the world. Examples of controllers that are shipped together with Kubernetes are deployment controller, stateful set controller, or job controller. For our case, we implemented a custom Airflow worker set controller that replaces the existing deployment. And now it is responsible for managing the workers and apply any changes to them. For scale up, it just adds more workers. For upgrade, it replaces all the existing workers with a new version. And during scale down, so this is actually the critical part, during scale down, it connects to the Airflow database, gets a list of workers which don't run any task, and removes only workers from that list. So of course, it may happen that we are not able to remove that many workers that we want, and we end up with a higher number of workers than desired. But in this case, we just need to wait for task to be finished. So it means we never remove a worker running a task. This makes sure that tasks are saved until they are done. And of course, just note, there is no transaction. So it is possible that the worker started the task between the time we checked the DB and we killed it. But yeah, honestly, I was never able to encounter this situation during my test, or it didn't cause any problems like failed task. The time windows is pretty short, so actually this is just a fraction of seconds. So So I believe just workers don't have much time to start anything, or even if they do, they probably are not able to make much progress for the task. Okay, so this is what we have now. So what are our plans for the future? One idea that we have is scaling down to zero. Like HPA does not support it out of the box. We also can't do that right now because we run our monitoring tags to report the environment healthiness. So of course we need at least one worker to handle this tag. And we plan to scale down not only the workers, but also scheduler and other components to lower the cost as much as possible. This could be useful for users that run Composer environment occasionally. And the other option that we consider is adding an auto-scaling for scheduler HA. The only problem is how we should define the proper metric for HPA and for scaling up and down the scheduler. Okay, that's all that we have for today. Thank you very much.